Welcome! This is an introductory course to 3D printing. This video introduces about 35 topics helpful for 3D printer selection and 3D printing success. The topics are 3D printing filament path, the first layer, bed leveling, tuning changing certain settings during the 3D print without failure, 3D printing researching, 3D printer gotchas, problems and dependency chains, slicing software and features, 3D design and fixing tools for 3D objects, slicing your 3D objects, cheap versus expensive 3D printers, 3D printer styles, stereolithography, which is resin, liquid resin based, and FDM, which have four subcategories: FDM Cartesian, Delta, Core XY, and tool changer / multi-materials. Extruder categories and subcategories, multi-materials options and add-ons, hot ends, types and styles, support in 3D printing, getting parts and tools, stepper motors, 3D printer motherboards, stepper motor controllers, power supplies, JST connectors, wires and crimpers, firmware updates, firmware compiling and firmware names, VREF and multimeter, 3D printer rails, timing belts, gears and pulleys and idling pulleys, 3D printer pliers and cutters, Zoron pliers, heat guns, lead screws, 3D printer calibration, remote 3D printing and monitoring, 3D printer starter kit, 3D printing cooling, storage organization, and safety. 3D printing filament path. I would like to define the filament path and coin the term filament path because it seems that most of the times problems in 3D printing are either within the filament path or in the rest of the 3D printer itself. The filament path is composed from the spooler itself and the way the filament is wound on the spool, the distance and obstacles, and most importantly the resistance the filament meets from the spool to the extruder gears pulling the filament from the spool and pushing it towards the nozzle, the extruder gears and orifices in the extruder, the pneumatic fittings and the Bowden tube, the heat sink, the heat break throat, the heat block, the thermistor, and the nozzle. These are all components of the filament path. 3D printing the first layer. The first layer is the most important, just like the foundation of the building. Use glue on the first layer, Elmer's Extreme Glue Stick and or hairspray. The first layer depends on the bed leveling. Use a wide brim and dial in the first layer height while printing the brim. Automatic bed leveling makes it easier, but if the probe goes bad, then you're stuck. If the bed is warped and you do not have mesh bed leveling, then you'll have to compromise a little on the corners and the center of the bed. Bed leveling. Bed leveling can be a manual process or automatic. The automatic bed leveling can have the mesh feature to compensate for uneven portions of the bed. For automatic bed leveling, you have a few probe options, each with its advantages and disadvantages. You have capacitance probe, inductance, infrared, and BL touch. There may be other pros, but these are the most common. If the bed leveling probe fails, then you cannot print and you have to disable it in the firmware or find a way to introduce the G-code that will disable it in the 3D print you want to print. Tuning and changing certain things during the print without failing your 3D print. Just as adjusting the bed leveling during the printing, you can adjust the cooling fan and the nozzle and the bed temperature. Also, if you do not like your model being 3D printed and your 3D printer can resume 3D prints after power interruptions, then you can cut the power, reslice and resave the model with the same name and then resume 3D printing like nothing happened with the new settings. The trick is where to interrupt the 3D print. 3D printing researching. Research slicer profiles for your 3D printer. Sometimes it may be a slicer issue rather than a 3D printer hardware issue. 3D printing research gets very involved because of dimensions and specifications as well as fitting the parts together. You must find if the upgrades you're planning will fit your current setup. 3D printer upgrades demand more upgrades in certain instances, so it's a dependency chain. Use Facebook groups, forums, Reddit, 3D printing dedicated websites and blogs to find exactly what you need to do to fix or upgrade your particular setup. Always look it up and sometimes just ask the questions rather than assume, because your assumption cannot take in consideration certain safety features. Do keywords research on Amazon reviews on your uncertain that the part will fit your current setup, or ask questions on the forums. 3D printer gotchas, problems and dependency chain, root causes. When 3D printing, you won't know if what you fixed is properly fixed until you 3D print a test print. You better stack up on some patience because 3D printing is slow and very slow. If you want quality, it will drive you quite mad, especially if you see excellent results online from other people. Sometimes you may do upgrades because you could not find the actual root cause of a problem. Ask questions or troubleshoot the filament path. Most problems lie in the filament path, and that is also the most delicate to work with, and some parts require heating up before dismounting them. Try a different slicer if everything should work, but it still does not. 3D designs and fixing tools. I would say you can use Blender, SolidWorks, Onshape, Autodesk Fusion 360, Autodesk NetFab, Autodesk Mesh Mixer, SketchUp, to name just a few. 3D design is a major topic in itself, and any one of the mentioned software requires hundreds of hours of practice to get quite good at 3D designing objects. However, with quick tutorials on YouTube, you can actually modify existing parts to your needs with just a few minutes of watching and tinkering. Slicing software and features. Do not use the Cura slicer, but if you're hell-bent on using the Cura slicer, add the CreaAwesome plugin and use a Creality printer profile that matches your 3D printer volume. Other slicers to use are Slicer Prusa Edition, Slicer, KISS Slicer, Idea Maker, Ice SL, Craftware, AstroPrint, Matter Control, Simplify 3D. Simplify 3D is a premium-only version that costs $150, but a lot of people swear by it. So take your pick here. Repetier is a wrapper that uses four slicer engines: Cura Engine, Prusa Slicer Engine, and SkeinForge Engine. SkeinForge seems to not be maintained anymore. Repetier is great because you can visualize your slice model in different color gradients which match at different speeds. Then you can match your 3D printed object portions to the speeds with the best printed results, and then tune in your desired 3D printing speed for your 3D printer. However, you must be aware that traveling at an optimum speed may take acceleration and distance, and small lattices may not be thick enough for the nozzle to get to the desired speed and get the desired 3D printing results. Slicing your 3D designs or download objects workflows and tips. Slicing your 3D objects transforms them from manifold meshes into layers defined by coordinates in G-code. To slice properly, you need to memorize a lot of settings and adjust them for certain types of prints and requirements. There isn't a one-size-fits-all here. If there's one good use for Cura, is to find defective meshes. One good add-on for Cura is CreaAwesome that will make Cura print a lot better. Slicing is about developing a workflow of settings and profiles to use in certain conditions. Once you get good with one slicer, you may want to branch out to others because they offer somewhat different features which will improve your prints. Cura has a lot of options and features, but I could never get good results with it, but frustrations and retries. Cheap versus expensive 3D printers. Here's the chicken and the egg problem all over again. If you want to start tinkering from the get-go, then get a cheaper 3D printer, but research its problems because you may get turned off quickly if the 3D print or printer continuously fail. If you want to print from the start with no fixes and upgrades, then you must buy a more expensive 3D printer. I would suggest either Prusa, TierTime, Cetus, Creality CR10S Pro, or Creality CR10 Max, or 2-Tree Sapphire. Research the assembly because it differs for each 3D printer. TierTime Cetus Extended It has been getting good reviews and has been sold out for a long time in the US. Then you can get a Creality CR10S Pro, but they do have issues. But they are at a good settle point in quality of prints, reliability, and price. One other contender may be the Snapmaker 2, but that still does not ship until 2020. That 3D printer has a lot of options, but it comes with a year-ish of wait time. A cheap, good 3D printer that has been gaining ground is 2-Tree Sapphire Core XY. Mine was able to complete a demanding cellular lamp twice. 2-Tree Sapphire is coming out with another Core XY with a larger volume, 300 millimeters cubed. Basically, the expensive 3D printers use upgraded components or new design components to solve known problems. For example, I read some reviews about the Trunxy that you will have to update most of the parts after buying to get it to be reliable. So basically, you're buying the frame and the design rather than having to design it yourself and cut the rails yourself. To understand better the expensive versus cheap 3D printers, keep following along as we'll cover most of the 3D printing topics. 3D printer styles: SLA and FDM, Cartesian, Delta, and Core XY, and maybe tool changer and multi-materials. Core XY 3D printers have the advantage because they move the least amount of mass, thus creating very little vibrations or jerk and limited artifacts on your 3D print. Then you have the Cartesian 3D printers, which move the bed on the y-axis, and as the 3D print grows, so does the mass, and so will the artifacts on the 3D print. Then the Delta 3D printers move the axes up and down, and they have a 3D printing head that moves and deposits layers of filament. The Delta style can be very fast or faster than the Core XY or the Cartesian, but they can never carry too much mass on the 3D printing head. So they must have a bone type extruder where the stepper motor is separated from the hot end. There is a tool changer that is being developed by E3D, but it isn't available yet, and it is designed for more mass production, and it needs to be tooled just like a lathe. The good thing about it is that you can use multiple colors and materials in your 3D print. The multi-material 3D printers can be any of the Delta, Cartesian, or Core XY, but they have multiple extruders, most of the time too. And you can use those multiple extruders for multiple colors or for water-soluble supports. And then you have another completely different category, the resin 3D printers, the SLA or stereolithography. They can 3D print details beyond the capabilities of all the 3D printers based on the filament and heat, the FDMs. But SLAs are messy and the resin, from what I've researched, is quite toxic. You need gloves and handle with care. SLA 3D printers work with the laser that hardens the resin into a soft, rubbery, flexible shape, and only after you must cure it in UV light or in the sun. FDM filament 3D printers start at a tenth of a millimeter's precision. The SLA's upper precision ends at a tenth of a millimeter, thus the details can be very, very rich. Stay tuned for the next video on introduction to 3D printing.